Now I am going to touch upon very important things which are sacredly personal, Saint Germain explained, speaking directly to Nada, Pearl, Rex, and Bob Singleton. I do not wish you to feel that I intrude upon your sacred private affairs, or that I take of you because of the power I possess an advantage use. However, there are certain things that I must make unmistakably plain to you. Rex and Pearl are twin rays from the same divine flame. The flame comes forth from the heart of God, the great life consciousness of the universe, the great central sun. When you, the mighty I Am presence, will to come forth into an individualized focus of conscious dominion and use the creative word, I Am, your first individual activity is the formation of a flame. Then you, the individualized focus of the mighty I Am presence, begin your dynamic expression of life. This activity we term self-consciousness, meaning the individual who is conscious of his source and perfection of life expressing through himself. Only the self-conscious individual has all the attributes and creative power of the mighty I Am presence. Only he can know who and what he is and express the fullness of the creative power of God whenever he decrees, by the use of the words, I Am. The outer human part of this activity is what we call the personality. It is but the vehicle through which perfection should be expressed into the outer substance of the universe. Within the pure God flame is a breath that pulsates constantly. This great fire breath is a rhythmic outpouring of divine love, its three attributes being love, wisdom, and power in action. These pour out constantly into the infinite sea of pure electronic light. This light is the universal substance or spirit, out of which all forms are composed. It is intelligent mark you because it obeys law through the command of the individual who says or is conscious of, I Am. These two words are the acknowledgement and release of the power to create and bring forth into outer existence whatever quality follows that acknowledgement. For intelligence to act, there must be intelligence to be acted upon, and the universal substance, being like a photographic film, takes the record of whatever quality the individual imposes upon it through his thought, feeling, and spoken word. The words, I Am, whether thought, felt, or spoken, release the power of creation instantly. Make no mistake about this. Intelligence is omnipresent, and it is within the electronic light. The first fiat of creation that went forth into infinity was, let there be light, and then creation took place, for out of this primal light comes all manifested form. The light is the central point of life or energy within every atom, composing the substance from which comes all physical manifestation. I speak of the atom because the lower rate of vibration composing the physical manifestation is the atomic structure which we have under consideration. When you consciously envelop or hold any person, place, condition or thing in the dazzling white light, you are penetrating, going through the atomic structure into the electronic, wherein there is no imperfection. In this use of the light, one penetrates the structure of imperfection, and that on which the attention is centered is then brought forth perfect not only as the Father sees it, but it is the Father's perfection expressed. You, as the Son, are given choice, commanded to choose and direct where the energy which is the activity of the light shall go. It is imperative to have your conscious thought, your firm attention on what is to be accomplished in order to give the needed direction to the activity of this mighty force which it is your right and privilege to use. When you use the dazzling white light, you are actually accepting the electronic structure which is then present in manifestation, for you are acting from the plane of action, or perfect manifestation. Your desire, when held steady, unwaveringly, becomes the conscious thought directing, for you cannot have a desire without conscious thought in the desire. Great strides have been made in the higher use of the light at the inner levels in the past 15 years. Your conscious great adherence to the light shows you are ready for its highest use. If in your use of the light, you will know the perfection of what you wish is already present in manifestation the moment you start the dynamic action of the light, it will remove all uncertainty in your mind as to the positive assurance of the manifestation, or what you wish, taking form in your physical use. In clothing or visualizing any person, place, object or condition with the illuminated figure of Jesus Christ, or the figure of any other ascended master, you are really unclothing, penetrating through the atomic garment where you see, recognize, and accept the perfection you now want present in form, for you have swept aside all imperfection in the action. The student should see and feel his body as if composed of pure white flame sending out long rays of light. The flame is your real self, the mighty I Am presence, the full Christ perfection. The rays shooting forth are the divine mind, or, love in action. These rays are what follow your conscious direction, carrying your thought and producing magical results when consciously directed, held firm by determined, unwavering, conscious attention. The light you thus visualize is the electronic substance the Hindus call prana. This light is always directed by thought, but it is imperative that all learn to control and direct it consciously. This conscious control and direction is how the ascended masters accomplish such marvelous results. Divine love is a presence, an intelligence, a principle, a power, an activity, a light and a substance. When we command divine love to go forth and do anything, we are setting into motion the highest form of action, the most powerful force. This, however, does not require terrific effort. In fact, it requires just the opposite. It is a calm, steady, determined, conscious knowing. As this becomes a fixed consciousness, an absolute certainty in one's conscious awareness, he will find more and more instantaneous response to his demand and command. Never be afraid to demand and command anything that is a universal principle of life. Make no mistake, the light, the universal electronic substance, is for your use as at your command. Your mighty I Am presence is a self-conscious being of which your outer consciousness is but a fragmentary part. Therefore, you can talk to your mighty master within as you would to a loving father who possessed limitless light, love, riches, power, health, happiness, or anything you could desire. For the more you consciously use this mighty presence of the I Am, the quicker will it respond to you. Divine love can control all manifestation. If in your use of divine love you are conscious that it has within itself all love, wisdom and power of this mighty I Am presence, the fact is that you qualify this principle which you command with whatever quality you are conscious of as being within it. You are given dominion over everything in the air, in the earth, in the fire, and in the water through the command of this mighty universal principle, which is always at your conscious service and for your use. Love, divine mind, and prana are one in the static or still state. Through the conscious action of the individual, divine love consciously directed becomes love, wisdom and power in action. This is why divine love consciously directed to accomplish things produces such marvelous results. It becomes instantaneous and all-powerful as soon as the outer consciousness ceases to limit it. Now to return to the explanation of the rays, the almighty God flame, breathing within itself, projects two rays into the great sea of pure electronic light. This intelligent light substance becomes the clothing, as it were, for these rays of the mighty I Am presence. Each ray has all the attributes of the Godhead within it, and no imperfection can ever enter into or register upon it. The individualized flame sends down into each ray a focal point or spark, forming a heart center upon which gathers the electronic light substance, creating the electronic body. Around this it sends out rays of lesser intensity that form an aura or force field. This force field is sometimes referred to as the causal body, and within it are deposited the results of all constructive effort during and between each embodiment. All electronic substance that has been used constructively by the personal self through physical experience is also deposited within it. Through it, the God flame can send out into space a greater release of its own life wave. The causal body, through the personality's journey in physical experience, becomes an ever-expanding sun and a self-sustained outpouring of limitless ideas, love, wisdom and power, flowing out forever on rays of love to the rest of this universe. This sun is in reality a reservoir of constructively used energy and substance, gathered through human experience and drawn upward, so it becomes the glory of the God flame, which, mark you, never loses its individual identity in the universe. This is how the beautiful, joyous, perfect, limitless activity of life and creation goes on ever expanding its perfection. The universal substance and energy which the personal self uses discordantly accumulates in the atmosphere around the physical body of both the personality and the earth. Periodically it builds a vortex and can only be purified and returned to the great sea of universal light by the activity of the fire element. The purifying process of the fire element acting within the flesh of the human body to consume wrong qualities sometimes produces the sensation of pain if wrongly qualified by the personality, but if the fire element acts within the flesh of the human body to vivify and energize, it produces the sensation of peace, exhilaration and ecstasy. If acting in the atmosphere of the earth and within nature to purify, it sometimes produces volcanic and cataclysmic conditions. When acting to vivify and energize in nature, it produces marvelous growth and pure, rarefied air which vitalizes all. The personal self of every individual is endowed with the power of choice as to what it wishes to think, to feel, to create and experience. If one uses all the substance and energy of his being constructively, then peace, expansion, joy, opulence, and glory are the return unto life for the outpouring of its gifts. If one chooses and creates otherwise, his misery and destruction return into himself and destroy his body. The personal self is a custodian of life, of ideas, and of light substance, pure electronic substance. The very fact that one is in existence as a human being is an open acknowledgement to those who are able to read the Book of Life, that he has decreed to come into individual existence and accepted of his own choice the responsibility of being a creator. Everyone must carry the responsibility of his world. If he has created, because of the appetites of the physical body, things and conditions he does not enjoy, he has all power to purify and dissolve them by the right use of the fire element of which divine love is the highest, most powerful, and eternal activity. If he desires to set his personal self and world in order and therefore have peace and create a world of joy, perfection and glory, he must look to his electronic body for the pattern of his divine perfection, for it cannot and never will be found anywhere else. There, and there only, can the personal self ever find security, rest, satisfaction, joy, and the fulfillment of every constructive desire, for in the fullness of the presence, are the things that you desire. This perfect, eternal, electronic body abides from 12 to 50 feet above the physical body of every individual, unless he be a very low or destructive type, when it withdraws still farther away. This is the Sun and Son of God, for the electronic body of every individualized flame of God is a dazzling, blazing light of such intensity that the human eyes can only gaze upon it for the fraction of a second. By adoration to the God flame and purification of its instrument, the personal self, the outer activity of the mind and physical body becomes raised in vibratory attunement to see the electronic body clearly within the blazing light of the force field around it. The physical body or actual atomic structure of the flesh is the densest form and is the record of the outer activity of the mind. In certain phases of religious explanation concerning this electronic body, it has been referred to many times as the guardian angel. It is all of that and more when really understood and comprehended. To it, the personal self should look for the supply of every good thing as a child looks to its mother. All that is within the God flame flows into the electronic body, where the tremendous power and intensity of the light of the mighty I AM presence is stepped down to a degree that can act in the vibratory octave of the physical world. From the heart center of the electronic body flows a stream of life essence, or liquid light, which enters the physical body through the pineal gland and fills the nerve channels. This liquid white fire flows through the nerves as blood does through the veins. This beats the heart, moves the muscles of the body, and enables one to walk or raise the hand. It is also the energizing light within the brain cells. The life stream of the body has often been referred to as the silver cord. So it is, for the stream of liquid white light pulsates continually through the flesh body by way of the nervous system. At so-called death, the God presence withdraws the stream of liquid light, and the flesh disintegrates. The reason the race continues to experience so-called death is because of the waste of this electronic light through emotional excesses, instead of retaining it within the physical brain and body to rebuild the cellular structure and supply the motive power for the entire body. Mankind does not like to hear this truth, but the waste of the life energy through uncontrolled feeling is the cause of the disintegration of all physical bodies outside of violence. If one uses the inner sight to observe the life stream of a strong, healthy child, he will see the nerves of the body full of this dazzling liquid white light. Then if he observes the body of the same child when ill or fatigued, he will see the light greatly diminished. In an old body, it is still more greatly dimmed, and if one wishes to observe the soul passing out of the body at so-called death, he will see this life stream entirely withdrawn at the top of the head, until it becomes only a thin thread of light which finally breaks. At that moment, the heart ceases to beat. Again, let us return to the explanation of the rays. Nada and Bob Singleton are two other rays of an individualized God flame. Whether you choose to accept this wonderful fact depends entirely upon yourselves. I do not even suggest, but knowing the secret feeling of your hearts as I do, it is my privilege to disclose this much. It will explain some of the feeling which you have not understood. My sincere hope is that all four of you will be able to raise your bodies in this life with the outer attention consciously directed to that point. With the 67 assistance which we can give at the proper time, you will be able to accomplish the final attainment. I feel your gratitude, for which I thank you. In answer to your thought of why this glorious privilege is yours, I want you to know that it is because of previous growth. Your own indwelling, mighty IAM presence, commands it for your safeguard and illumination. I shall now give you the explanation of the law by which you are able to illuminate, raise the physical body, and express the full dominion, victory, and freedom of the ascended masters. The seed within man and woman is only intended for the sacred office of creating a body by which another soul may come into physical embodiment. At all other times, the glorious light within the body should be raised into the top of the head and allowed to flow up in adoration unto the mighty IAM presence. Then by uplifted thoughts and feeling, one can do creative work at the mental level through glorious ideas, ideals of art, music, invention, discovery, research, and the creation of beauty and harmony of every description through a service that blesses humanity, and therefore the individual who gives it. Instead of wasting the wonderful liquid light, the marvelous God-given essence of life, in sex sensation and excesses, whereby the body becomes decrepit, flabby, crippled, face lined, eyes dull, the whole structure stooped and feeble, the brain inactive, sight and hearing impaired, and the memory not able to function, this energy should be rightly used in wonderful, idealistic creative activity. In such constructive consciousness and accomplishment, the physical body would remain eternally youthful and beautiful, the brain and faculties keen, alert, and active, and the whole physical expression would become the image and likeness of the living God, truly the temple of the Most High. Your bodies are now calling for their accustomed rest. The chambers are in readiness. Sleep until you awaken. I commend you to the embrace of your glorious, mighty IAM presence. Rest in peace. We returned to our beautiful sleeping chambers where all was in readiness. The most delightful fragrance of roses permeated everything, and we 68 certainly never rested upon more comfortable couches, nor enjoyed such divine repose. Rex was very happy to find that Pearl was the twin ray of his own God flame, and in speaking of her after he and I had gone to our room, said, "Ever since we first met, I have felt a strange attraction to Pearl, and whenever in her presence, I am always conscious of a sense of quiet contentment. Our blessed Saint Germain has certainly explained almost wonderfully, and I am deeply grateful. In giving this explanation to me some months ago, I replied, he said to me, 'The beautiful love of one ray for its twin ray is tremendously uplifting, exalting, wonderful, and infinitely more joyous than when the great current of liquid fire, the life stream of the universe, is turned downward and becomes passion. This mighty, concentrated electronic force, or life essence, is a liquid light which flows wherever the attention directs it. The mind's attention is pulled this way and that by thought, feeling, sight, and hearing, in fact by the pull of all the physical senses. The true understanding of what mighty power is at your command when you have full control over your attention cannot be overestimated. The liquid electronic essence is this mighty energy, and it energizes whatever the attention rests upon. If one be doing intense mental work, the liquid light stays within the brain and flows forth through the center of the forehead between the eyes as a ray of light, and if the inner sight be opened, one can easily and always see it. If one be speaking, this pure mighty energy flows forth through the throat center as sound. If one be pouring out divine love, this liquid light flows forth as a radiance from the heart center. If one be sending out intense feeling, it flows forth from the solar plexus. Here it also performs the function of digesting the food. If one has the inner sight opened, he will see a stream of light pouring out from whatever center the energy is being used at the moment. This pure liquid light becomes colored by whatever quality the personality imposes upon it through the thought, feeling, and spoken word. Here lies one's responsibility as a creator, and the means by which he can correct or purify whatever has been wrongly created. If this life essence is released at the generative center for sex pleasure instead of building a new physical embodiment for another soul, the process of disintegration of the physical body is started, and the journey to self-generated dissolution of the body begins. It matters not what human opinion says to the contrary, this is the inevitable, inexorable law of physical embodiment, and there is no person in the universe who can change it. This is the principal reason for the condition that is called death within the race as a whole. Let anyone who disagrees with this truth compare the brain and body of one who conserves this liquid light over a period of a few years with that of one who has wasted it over a similar period, and he will not need any other proof. The conservation of this liquid electronic light and the conscious lifting of it by adoration to the mighty I Am presence, and by the power of the mind through the control of the attention is the way of perfection, and is safe, sound, sensible and reasonable. It can have only harmonious, constructive results to the mind, the body and world of the individual. This is not a system of repression by the power of the human will. That is and will always be disastrous, for to dam up a highly concentrated energy and then by thought, feeling and suggestion keep driving more of it to that point through thinking upon it in secret, must of necessity cause an explosion of some kind to take place. That method never was the original spiritual teaching of anyone who really knew and understood the truth and the law concerning it. Humanity has not, except in a very small degree, understood this truth, or thousands would have become ascended masters long before now. In order to rise out of the degradation, misery, poverty, and disaster in which the mass is now wallowing, the individual must come to a clear understanding of this law in the outer activity of his mind. Through his conscious knowledge and control of the emotions, he shuts the door to the most dangerous and subtle suggestions from the psychic plane, which is the most unrecognized enemy and vicious activity of the sinister force in this world. The feeling nature of mankind is a reservoir of energy, and it is impossible for thoughts to become things until one propels them forth into the sea of electronic substance by feeling. As we retired, the glorious illumination of our room faded out, and we were soon fast asleep. Such heavenly rest none of us had ever before experienced. We must have slept fully 12 hours when the most glorious tones of a bell sounded through the chamber, and the dazzling illumination gradually again filled the room. When we had bathed and donned our robes, we found a most delicious breakfast awaiting, served on an exquisite crystal top table which neither of us had noticed as being there before. On it was food of which we had never heard, more delicate and delicious than can ever be served by any culinary artist of this world. The dishes looked as if they were made of mother of pearl, with heavy gold bands, and the rest of the service was made of wonderful semi-transparent metal with pearl handles. We dined and were discussing the wonders we had been experiencing, when the table with its entire beautiful service disappeared before our eyes. Again the sound of the beautiful bell filled the chamber. We went to the reception room and there found Nada and Pearl awaiting us. They looked radiantly beautiful. Youth always responds marvelously to the mighty magic presence, but in this change a transformation had taken place that was more than usual, with both of them revealing a radiance which had never been in either of them. Both showed the awakening of a great love, and while they had experienced the same wonderful rest as we, yet they had undergone an even more wonderful change. We had only been talking a few moments when the great doors to the crystal chamber opened. We entered and found 12 more ascended masters present, making 24 with those whom we had already contacted while in this retreat. Saint Germain presented us to them, and I noticed one lady and one gentleman around whom the light was dazzling, for their radiance shone brighter than the others. They came directly over to Nada and Rex, and with indescribable grace, greeted them both. "Beloved brother and sister," said the lady, "we come directly from the sphere in which your dearly beloved mother sojourns. It is not her home, but she is there for certain training. You did not know it at the time, but if you could have looked within the casket before your mother was supposedly placed in the sarcophagus, you would not have found her physical body. We were two of the 12 present who were with the mighty Master Saint Germain when the assistance was given that enabled her to be raised into her eternal electronic body. She wishes you to know this now that you have become aware of and have accepted the great ascended Master's way of life. These, our blessed ascended brothers, have found that each of you can be given the necessary assistance to raise your bodies as she has done when the humanly accustomed time of your earthly pilgrimage is finished. The third night here, she will come to you as we do now. Tonight, Nada and her father will have a very happy surprise. Again the bell sounded, and our beloved Saint Germain announced that all were to enter the electrical laboratory. Passing into that room, we found the marvelous atomic accelerator aglow with great currents of light. He asked Daniel Rayburn to take his place in the chair. The two radiant masters stood at opposite points in the circle, one in front, the other behind Rayburn Saint Germain standing within the circle of 21. Again he asked me to watch the process closely. In an instant, the light within Rayburn's body began to increase, and his face revealed great joy. Within the light around him were particles of substance, continually rising as the impurities in his physical body were thrown off and consumed. This lasted about 10 minutes, then I saw his hair gradually return to its natural color, a dark brown, and his face become radiant and youthful. The light within the chair gradually disappeared, and the laboratory was again as usual. Saint Germain extended his hand to Mr. Rayburn and he stepped down lightly, as if scarcely conscious of any weight. For more than an hour, the radiance about his face and the brilliant light within his eyes was most remarkable. Words can never describe the marvels I have experienced, he said, turning to us, and for the first time in my life, I am beginning to know the real meaning of life. We do not dream in the unascended state what a small fraction of the mighty principle of life we appropriate and use in our ordinary mundane experience. Each of you, said Saint Germain, has been tremendously uplifted through the powerful radiation of this marvelous atomic accelerator. We returned to the crystal chamber and noticed that chairs to seat 24 persons had been placed around the large crystal top table. The two radiant masters took their seats at the ends, our beloved master in the middle, and Nada opposite him. Focus your attention upon Bob Singleton, he said, addressing Nada, and request him to come to us. Almost instantly, a soft rose-colored light enveloped all, accompanied by a most delicate fragrance of roses. In a few moments a beautiful blue formed around the rose-colored circle. This was followed by a radiance of gold around the blue. Then we heard a sound like the swish of wings, and Bob Singleton, in a tangible, visible body stood upon the table before us accompanied by the two radiant masters who before had been sitting at the ends of the table. I had not noticed that they had left until their return with Bob. As he stood there, I could see his form becoming more and more dense, until presently his body was as tangible as my own. Saint Germain arose and extended his hand to Bob as he stepped lightly from the table. We all rose to our feet, and Nada looked steadily at him an instant as the rest were about to offer their greetings. Bob put his arms around her and held her close to his heart. My precious love, he said, I have always seen you in my dreams. When you came to the mine, I knew you as my angel love, but you seem so far beyond me, I did not even dare to hope. Now to hold you in my arms is the most divine thing I know. In the glorious freedom of this inner body I see the light of divine love between your blessed brother and my dear sister. My gratitude is boundless. Daniel Rayburn stepped forward with extended hands and gave his blessing to this great and divine love, then turning to Pearl and Rex, gave them his blessing also, saying that in his highly attuned state, he realized all more clearly. Will I be able to remember this, said Bob, turning to Saint Germain, when I return to my body, and he replied, you shall do so if you wish. The privilege granted you at this time is a very rare occurrence, for you are clothed in a temporary body. However, it is just as tangible as your own physical body and as the physical bodies of the others here. Everyone came forward and congratulated the happy lovers, the ascended masters making a connecting link through which assistance could be given at any time in the future in case of need. It was then we were told that the two radiant masters were also twin rays. The ascended masters present knew Bob from contact with him in the higher spheres, but he did not retain the memory of his acquaintance with them. When Saint Germain stepped forward, Bob would have kneeled before him. No, Bob, he said, raising his hand in protest, your own indwelling I am presence is just as great as the ascended masters who have found the way before you to complete mastery and freedom. To it belongs your first love, recognition, and worship at all times. Never forget that. I am your elder brother, that is all, and it is my privilege to assist you to that same freedom. It is at the command of your own, mighty I am presence, that you are enabled to be here in this manner tonight. It is always a joy to be of any assistance that the great law of your being permits. I wish you to come tomorrow night in this same manner, that you may meet your sweetheart's mother, for she will also be here at that time. Much is being done which you do not now understand, but your beautiful love and trust is opening wide the gates to blessings of which you do not dream. However, the full understanding will come as you progress. Arrange your work at the mine so as to retire promptly at 9 o'clock. Now you must return to your physical body. He then asked us all to form a circle about Bob. In a few moments the radiant circle of light in rose, blue, and gold again enveloped us. The two radiant masters took their places beside Bob, and in an instant, all three disappeared. The rest of us walked about in the crystal chamber, and in about 20 minutes the radiant ones reappeared in our midst. Never in my whole existence have I ever experienced such wonderful joy and unspeakable divine love as radiated from everyone present. This finished our work until the following evening. The 12 ascended masters who had appeared last formed into a circle, and in a few moments, disappeared from view. The remaining 6, after extending to us their blessing, vanished before our eyes. We all gathered around our beloved Saint Germain in boundless gratitude for the marvels we had witnessed and the limitless blessing we had received. My beloved students, he explained, do you not see how much easier, how much more joyous it is to rise above all human, earthly limitations and produce whatever you require direct from the universal substance which is the eternal, omnipresent supply of everything you can ever desire? Each one of you who has been requested to come here can learn to do this much sooner than you dare to imagine in the outer activity of your mind. The time required to attain this mastery is tremendously shortened when the individual comes to the understanding that his physical body is the temple of the mighty I am presence, the God of the universe, and the very life energy which moves his body across the floor as the most high living God. This is the Christ, the only begotten Son God in action. However, I find many who get tremendous results by thinking of it as the ascended master within, or the mighty I am presence, to whom they can talk. This presence is a glorious blazing light. You can see its light within your outer mind and body, its visible, tangible presence resting a short distance above your physical body. You can speak to it and receive its definite answers, perfect direction and wondrous revelation. You can thus always be God-directed if you will only contact your mighty I am presence, close enough and often enough. Its mighty wisdom, 75 intelligence and liquid light will flow ceaselessly into whatever you wish to accomplish if you will but hold your attention steadfast upon the mighty presence, first and whatever you wish to attain second. Then follow this up by determined, persistent insistence. Such almighty power and intelligence is absolutely invincible and can never fail. Human doubt and fear, which are subtle feelings, can keep you from accepting this mighty I am presence, and its perfection if you let them, but the presence never did and never can fail. This is a simple formula for quick, certain attainment. You cannot possibly estimate what tremendous advancement is possible in a short time if you will, because you can consciously, continually, and completely accept the wonderful love, intelligence and power of the mighty I am presence, whose energy is flowing and acting through your mind and body every moment of the 24 hours. There is one point that real students and those who wish attainment should know unmistakably, and that is concerning desire. No one can ever attain mastery over human creation and gain the ascension by an attitude of desirelessness, because without desire for attainment, attainment would not be possible. Remember forever that all constructive desire is God in action in you, for if desire were not within the God principle, manifestation would never have taken place. Until the God had desired manifestation, it could not come forth. The activity of desire is the forward moving, or expanding motion of life itself, and can never be dispensed with. Life is perpetual motion, and the sustaining of that activity is all constructive desire. However, be careful that you discriminate between desire and human appetite, for they are as far apart as light and darkness. Appetite is but an accumulation of energy qualified by human feeling through the formation of habit in the sense organism only, and has nothing whatever to do with desire within God's life. For all that abides within life is pure, perfect, and constructive. Constructive desire is eternally existent within life. It is impossible to progress or express life without some form of desire. It is the student's duty to be alert and on guard, discriminating always as to his motive for doing anything. He needs to be severely honest with himself in his feeling and motive, for many times the outer activity of the mind tries to make one think he is doing a thing from the standpoint of reason, when all the time he is doing it to satisfy a feeling instead. As yet, the majority of the race are but creatures of feeling, for it controls them 90% more of the time than does the wisdom of the mind. That is why they are principally creatures of physical appetites instead of God-directed masters of circumstance and dominion. Until the student takes his feeling body in hand and definitely controls it by the love, wisdom and power of his mighty I AM presence, he cannot and never will be dependable, nor can he make permanent progress to freedom. The mighty I AM presence stores its force in the emotional body, or feeling body, and depends on this energy to accomplish the fulfillment of the perfect divine plan of life. Everyone knows the difference between a constructive and destructive idea, and the difference between the feeling of love, peace, and calm, and that of discord. So the simplest mind, even a child, innately knows the difference between the divine way of life, a God desire, and the human appetite for self-gratification. We are commanded to choose the divine way of life, and if we do not compel the sense appetites to obey that command, then we must suffer, experiencing chaos and destruction until we set our own world in order so it blends with the great, orderly, harmonious movement of the whole. Purity, order and harmony are the law of perfection forever. When one wishes to give way to his own feeling of resistance rather than still that feeling and replace it by peace, he destroys himself mind, body and world because the law is that whatever discordant thought and feeling is sent forth by a human being, it must first vibrate through the brain and body of the sender before it can reach into the rest of the universe. After swinging out, it begins the return journey to its creator. While coming back, it gathers more of its kind, and that becomes the accretion of which the individual's world is composed. This is the law, and it is immutable. When the great life energy within the physical body is used constructively, the result is the greatest possible joy, happiness, and accomplishment not only to ourselves, but to every person, place, condition and thing we control. Then the mighty I AM presence, through the vehicle of the personal self, manifests divine love in action, and the firmer and more concentrated the attention, the more powerful the action and the more marvelous the results. Now all go to your well-deserved rest. The all-powerful illumination and infinite peace of the Most High God attend each, for I shall have much to say to you at the close of our work tomorrow night. Let everyone remain in his bath not less than 15 minutes, it will be especially prepared. Then there will be food awaiting you. With my peace, strength, and love the first enfold you, and to your own, mighty I AM presence, I commend you all. Good night. We went to our respective chambers and found everything aglow with the vivifying life of the mighty I AM presence. The very atmosphere was charged with the pure electronic light. Upon entering my bath, I was delighted by the very living presence within the water. It was like the magic caress of the mother of all life. Every atom in my body was quickened into that radiant peace that passeth all understanding. When we were ready for the meal, we stood before the mirror and scarcely knew ourselves, each looked and felt glowing and radiant. Our repast was heavenly, and after finishing it, we retired at once. At 5 o'clock the following evening, we were awakened by the beautiful tone of the etheric bell sounding through our chambers, and we noticed the radiance of the light about us was much more dazzling than usual. It had been so quickened within our own bodies that its radiance emanated from our hands with great vividness.